and that you're going to make us like Jesus. Yes. Wow, I'm impressed. Yes. Can you do that, Lord? Yes. Us, Lord? All right. Then we want to cooperate so you can do it. Come, Holy Spirit, we need you. Come, Holy Spirit, teach us because you're the teacher and we're ready to learn. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, you got to watch out if you're ever introduced as an expert. You know, X is stands for the unknown, and a spurt is a drip under pressure. All right. Anyway, you know, if the Holy Spirit doesn't come tonight, you may as well have gone, stayed home, and watched TV. Because I'm like these other men and women keep saying, I'm not worth listening to unless the Holy Spirit can speak through me. So let's try that again. Heavenly Father, thank you that you love these people enough to speak even through me. And so do it tonight for Jesus' sake. Amen. Amen. All right. I want to start by telling you a story. It starts like this. She says to him, oh, kiss me with the kisses of your mouth, because your love is better than wine. Take me away with you. Hurry. King, take me into your chambers. And you're thinking, what? This is supposed to be a church service. That's Bible. That's Song of Solomon. Why do we have a love poem about a husband and a wife in the Bible? Because Jesus is the bridegroom. And the church is his bride. Now, what husband wouldn't want to hear his wife say that to him? She's hot for her man. And he's going to be happy. And do you think the church is ready for Jesus? Well, bridegroom and bride means a wedding, right? So, let me read a little more to you. It should come up on the screen now. A Song of Solomon, chapter 2. Like an apple among the trees of the forest is my lover among the young men. My wording might be just a little different than what you see up there, because that's New King James, and I'm reading from the NIV. That's the nearly inspired version. Have you heard that before? All of the translations have errors, but I've learned what these are, and I like where it's right. Like an apple tree among the trees of the forest. So we have, see, picture a forest, all right? It's all evergreens, needles, green, cold. However, there's an apple tree there. Like an apple tree among the trees of the forest is my lover among the young men. I delight to sit in his shade, and his fruit is sweet to my taste. This is the beloved speaking about her fiancé. This is how the bride feels about her groom. This is how the church should feel about Jesus. He has taken me to the banquet hall, and his banner over me is love. Strengthen me with raisins, refresh me with apples, for I am faint with love. Now, some of you are saying, what? Is it okay to get emotional when you're in love? I mean, this woman is lovesick. Do you think her fiancé wants her to love him like that? Oh, yeah. Do you think Jesus wants his church, his bride, to be faint with love? His left arm is under my head. His right arm embraces me. Listen, my lover, look, here he comes, leaping across the mountains, bounding over the hills. You remember the Superman, stronger than a speeding bullet? No, stronger, faster than a speeding bullet. Oh no, I blew it. Able to jump over buildings with a single bound. Is this silly? No, because there's an admiration that the woman has for her man. And the man wants to live up to it. He wants to earn it. He wants to deserve being the respected protector and provider for the wife. And then the kids as they come. And so she says, here he comes, leaping across the mountains, bounding over the hills. My lover is like a gazelle or a young stag. Look, there he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, peering through the lattice. My lover spoke to me and said, arise, my darling, my beautiful one, and come away with me. And that's what the end times are about. Jesus is going to come to take us away to be with him. And what's going to hold us through these terrible, terrible times we've been hearing about the last few Sunday evenings is our love for the King. It's our love for the King. It's the bride sick with love, faint with love. See, that's why there's no problem with his true people not falling away from him, no matter what the beast and the dragon and the false prophet do, because we're in love with our bridegroom. And there's no way we're going to worship some fool dragon. I mean, it's stupid if you know the truth. And our love is going to sustain us and keep us through the difficulties. Now, we're talking about bride and groom, so let's think wedding. I want to share with you a picture. Can we have it up there? What do you think when you think wedding? Can we have that picture? There it is. This is our wedding. See that? The bride down there with that beautiful gown on? You can't see much of her because she's facing the other direction. That's my beautiful blonde Linda. Yes. All right. So, all decked out. She was ready for the wedding. And there we are in a Baptist church. And this is what she looked like. Isn't that wonderful? Yes, that's her. Oh, I love that woman. I love that face. Yes. Okay, so it's about the bride at the wedding. And now, but then we had to leave. Let's see the last picture of this. There it is. This is the getaway car, all right? Can you read Azusa Pacific there? None of us had cars. Mine was so poor that I didn't even have it at where we got married, because there's another story there too. So my best man borrowed his aunt's car so that he could take us from the church where we looked like we were doing great to my little blue VW bug that had been built up from insurance wreckage. And when we went to our wedding dinner on the way on our honeymoon, I couldn't tip the guy who was parking the cars because I had to have him help me push start mine out of the parking lot. So anyway, that's another story. But yeah, weddings have a lot of different interesting things about them. But the wedding is about the bride and the groom. Now, let's take what we've been looking at already is some things about the groom in Song of Songs about how, so this is about a bride fit for the King. All right, the bride fit for the King. And the groom is tender, attentive, intimate, and engaging. That's what we saw in Song of Solomon. You know, my wife and oldest daughter love to watch Hallmark movies. Any of you ladies like Hallmark movies? You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, you know, you watch the first 10 minutes and you know how it's going to end. You know that the unlikely couple are going to eventually fall in love, and you just have to wonder what's going to keep them getting in the way and how they're going to get over their initial reactions against each other. But you know what? If you were to make a list of what are the qualities that the key man in the Hallmark movie has to be, the chick flick, right? He's got to be, you can make a long list of what it is. And why is the Hallmark Channel flourishing? Why are there millions of people watching this? Because it's part in us. We want that. We want to see happy endings. We want to see a man that's worth giving yourself for. We want to see a woman who finally recognizes that she was playing dumb and now it's smart to say yes to the good guy. Yeah, okay. So that's a part of what's in us. That's a part of how we're made. And that's a part. Jesus meets every single one of whatever that long list of things that qualify the guy to be the key man on the chick flick movie, right? Jesus really is tender, attentive, intimate, engaging. And he's after you and he wants you. And you can see it in his eyes, or you can feel his love if you pay attention. Another amazing thing about our bridegroom is that he's mighty, physically impressive warrior. You've got to see this. Turn with me, please, in Revelation, the 19th chapter. And you'll see a little more about why this is part of the end time series. In Revelation 19, starting at verse 11, we see this amazing thing happening. There have been people that have gathered together by the millions in an army to fight God. And that's right here. And it's you can read more about it in Revelation 16, how it's demonic, how the spirits went out of the mouths of the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet, did miraculous things before kings around the world to get millions of soldiers ready to fight Jesus in the Valley of Armageddon. Armageddon, we stood on Armageddon, several of us that are in here this evening, last July when we were in Israel. And that's an important place because of so many battles in history. That's the place of the greatest historical battles in the whole Palestine area, because it's where the trade routes from Egypt to Assyria met, and where anything coming in the Mediterranean had to go through to get inland to the valleys and the Jordan Valley where the people were living. And so that's where the armies were. There were great battles there throughout history. And so when we see, and we stood on Tel Megiddo, Armageddon, Har Megiddo, the hill of Megiddo, and looked across the valley and saw Nazareth a few miles away. And that's the place where there's going to be these millions of soldiers with weapons ready to fight God. And you're thinking, how could they be so stupid? Well, they've been proving their stupidity, if you read through the earlier chapters of the book of Revelation, by refusing every time God tried to save them. They refused, they refused, they refused. And you might think, well, God is mean, he's doing this stuff. Listen, every time God allows evil, it's because he wants good things to happen. And at the end of every outpouring of his wrath, we read, and they still didn't repent. And so after they've given themselves over to evil so many times, they come into what, you know, stupid is an interesting word. We're not supposed to use it in school. I'm a public school teacher, and I know because I've been told, don't let your kids say stupid. All right, but what is stupidity? Stupidity is a stupor. It's a spirit of being deceived into a stupor and acting like you're not in touch with reality. That's what stupid is. And these people really are. And once they get themselves so far, they will follow where the demons are leading. And then we see our groom, the bridegroom. I saw in heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice, he judges and makes war. Thank God, there's going to be finally some justice on earth. We look around us and we see evil win. We see terrible things happen. We see the bullies on top and the poor people on the bottom. We see things going wrong and we cry out, God, where are you? When are you going to do something about this? Well, I want you to know that God is sovereign Lord of history and he is going to do something about it. And this is when it's going to happen. His eyes are like blazing fire. On his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses, dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. Whatever happened to gentle Jesus, meek and mild? Hey, listen, you have to understand that Jesus is not like Santa Claus. Jesus loves righteousness and justice, and guess who's the judge on Judgment Day? Jesus. And he's not going to tolerate this garbage. There's a time when it's going to end, and he's going to end it. And your hero and mine, your bridegroom and mine, is going to say, that's enough! That's enough! It's over! Hallelujah! Now, I don't know what he's going to be wearing when he rides that white horse, but I'm planning on being one of those horses behind him. I'm on it. I'm on it. I'm looking forward to that. But at some point in the motion of this, part of his robe comes over, and you can see on his muscly thigh a tattoo. What? Jesus had a tattoo? 16, on his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Woo! That's my Jesus. And I saw an angel, let's get that down to 19. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against the rider on the horse and his army. But the beast was captured, with him the false prophet who had performed the miraculous signs on his behalf. With these signs, he had deluded those who had received the mark of the beast and worshipped his image. The two of them were thrown alive into the fiery lake of burning sulfur. The rest of them were killed with the sword that came out of the mouth of the rider on the horse. Hallelujah. History is going to end right, and Jesus is going to make it so. He's our hero. He's our judge. He's the ruler. He's not only marvelous and merciful, but he will end evil. Yes. How'd you like to have a husband like that, ladies? Well, you do. And guess what, men? So do we. Yes. Yes. All right, now let's take another look at this Jesus. We've seen his tender attentiveness. We've seen his mighty, physical, impressive warrior-ness. How does Jesus get his way? Jesus gets his way by giving, releasing, and exalting, not by withholding, controlling, and putting down. Now, those of you who are married, take a look at this. Especially you men. God has given us authority in our homes, but what are we doing with it? Are we following the example of Jesus? Are we going to exalt our wives or control them so that it can cover our insecurities and we can at least have somebody that does what we tell them to do? Are you following me? Yeah, yeah. So if we're going to follow Jesus, we need to follow him like, well, John 20. 20 and 21 is a fascinating thing about Jesus. Jesus didn't hold on to his equality with God the Father, but he came and gave us the authority he had. And he said, let's see, where am I here? John 20, 21 and 22. Jesus said, as the Father hath sent me, I am sending you the same way. Jesus didn't say, okay, I'm going to let you do a few things, but you're not going to get to do the good stuff like I do. Jesus exalted his church by passing on his commission to his bride, to us. After that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. So he gave us authority, he gave us power, and he has exalted us to do what he does on earth, what he did on earth. Matthew 10, 8, Jesus said these amazing words, heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out demons, cure the lepers. Freely you have received, freely give. What is Jesus doing here? He's passing on to you and me everything he did. That means you may think of yourself as a little pawn on a chessboard, but that's what the devil wants you to think. Jesus has made you the player who's moving the pieces. Revelation 3:21, Jesus said, to him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne. That's mind-boggling. That's the kind of groom you have, men and women who are the bride of Christ. He wants us to rule with him. He's treating us as if we are equal with him, and he is God. Wow, where did he learn that? He learned that from his father. Have you read Philippians 2? Revelation 22:5 ends with, we will reign with him forever. So this isn't just for a selfie in the throne room at the beginning of heaven. This is to sit on the throne and rule with him forever and ever. Wow. That means we've got some getting ready to do. But where did Jesus learn this? Well, you're familiar with Philippians 2, I hope. Jesus said, let this mind, or Paul said through the Holy Spirit, let this mind be in you which was in Christ. Which what? Christ, who, though he was equal to God, he didn't hold on to that, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, coming in the likeness of men, verse 8, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death on the cross. This is what Pastor Jim is preaching about this morning. Jesus set an even more phenomenal example of sacrifice than Abraham did. But what about his reward? Well, we'll get there. Became obedient to death. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, heaven and earth. Every demon is going to bow. They're not going to like it, but they're going to have to, because they're going to have to recognize, acknowledge Jesus is the Lord before they go to the lake of fire. So what did the Father do to Jesus? Jesus said, I'll go, Father. I'll humble myself and make the sacrifice and serve them. And the Father says, okay, let's do it. And then what did the Father do? Exalted Jesus above every name. So Jesus then followed the example of the Father with his bride. So he's exalting us to sit in his throne with him. Husband, what are you doing with your wife to demonstrate to her that she's your equal? I know she agreed to submit. If she's a Christian woman, she had to. But that doesn't mean that you control her and oppress her and make fun of her and put her down and say cutting things to keep her lower than you. If you're going to follow the example of Jesus, then you're going to need to raise her up. And that's what we need to do with our children as they grow through the teen years and into adulthood, right? So we're learning to practice what the Father did with Jesus and what Jesus did with the Son. Wait a minute, I thought this was a series on the end times, not family and marriage. It all fits together. It really does, because we're a family and we're a bride. Now, let's go to the next thing about this groom that makes him phenomenal and desirable, and that is he is wealthy beyond imagination. Now, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to read from chapter 21 in the book of the Revelation. This is the next to the last chapter of the Bible. And I wish I had time to spend an hour on this, but we don't. But you'll get the point if we go through it quickly. If you're paying attention, are you awake? Are you alert? Okay. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, no mourning, no crying, no pain, for the old order has passed away." Hallelujah! Now, do you remember Jesus taught us how to pray? "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So how do you know what's on earth in your sphere of influence that needs to be changed to the way it is in heaven? Here's a list for you. No more tears. Did you know that your home can be a little bit of heaven on earth? So that people who come there say, "Wow, it's so peaceful here. How is this different? How can I have a home like you do?" No more death, no more sorrow, no more crying, no more pain. You know how, I love the little booklet that Pastor Mike has written on healing for us here at The Rock. Do you know how you can tell that God wants you healed? Is there any sickness in heaven?
No.
No? As in heaven, so on earth. That's the stand we're supposed to take. Are there any broken marriages in heaven? Nope. No hard feelings, no unforgiveness, reconciliation all over the place. That's what God wants. See, when you get a picture of heaven, then you get a picture of what God wants your family, your home, your neighborhood, your business to be like. And isn't that going to be wonderful? Wow. He who is seated on the throne said, "I'm making everything new. Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." All right, let's drop down to verse 9 now. "One of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came to me and said, 'Come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb.' And he carried me away in the spirit to a mountain great and high and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. It shone with the glory of God, and its brilliance was like that of a very precious jewel, like a jasper, clear as crystal. It had great high wall with 12 gates and the 12 angels at its gates." We're going to drop down to verse 15 in a minute, but I want you to see a picture that I found online. Is that cool?
Yeah.
Huh. There's the New Jerusalem in a cloud coming down out of heaven. There's the artist's imagination, obviously. Artist, but wow, what an imagination. And it's good. We'll take a look at the second picture, but let's read verse 15 first. "The angel who talked with me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city, its gates and its walls. The city was laid out like a square as long as it was wide. He measured the city with the rod and found it to be 12,000 stadia in length and as wide and high as it is long. He measured," so that's a cube, right? Yeah. "He measured its wall and it was 144 cubits thick by man's measurement, which the angel was using." Now, let's see the second picture. So we have a New Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God, a cube. Look at that. Laid out like a square, as long as it was wide. Do you see the three gates on the bottom on one side and three gates? And see, there's a pearl. Each gate is an enormous pearl. Anyway, these are artists' renderings, but artists can get pictures that help us understand the significance and glory. These pictures may not be correct, but they are agreeing with what you just read about it being glorious, about being beautiful, about it being impressive. Now, what does this say, this and some other things about the new heaven and the new earth? The New Jerusalem, 12,000 stadia, calculates out to 1,384 miles. 1,384 miles. And the 144 cubits is 200 feet thick. Now, if you took the wall and did the calculation like I did, I'm a scientist. I do this. All right? So, you multiply the 1,400 miles by 5,280. You don't want to know the details, probably. It comes out to a ratio of 36,960 to 1. Are you impressed yet?
Yeah.
What is that supposed to mean? Well, let's suppose that this wall here is 30 feet high. If this wall is 30 feet high, the outside wall of the building we're in right now, is it 30 feet high? 35 maybe? Yeah, about that? All right. So if this wall is 30 feet high, and it's a block wall, so it's probably two blocks thick, which is what? About 16 inches. But if it were on the same proportion as, what happened to that picture? The cube. That wall, then it would only be a hundredth of an inch thick to have the same proportion. Huh? A hair, a human hair, on average, is about 0.004 inches thick. Are you impressed yet? That means that a wall 30 feet high would be structurally sound, being the thickness of two hairs. Can you imagine that? Now, we don't know very much about the new heaven and the new earth, but we know enough to know that either they've got some phenomenal building materials that we don't know anything about, or gravity's not the same. And I have an acquaintance, Dr. Hugh Ross, PhD astrophysicist, who has studied out a lot, and with a lot more understanding than I do. And he says that the new heaven and the new earth are going to have different physical laws than we have right now. There's going to be an enormous new habitat with no negative effects from thermodynamics, gravity, or electromagnetism. No darkness. Completely different dimensions, no grief, no remorse, no sadness, unimaginable splendor, joy, beauty, peace, and reward, continual fellowship with God, relationship limits lifted, you'll remember everybody's name, and pleasure limits lifted. Did you know God created you for pleasure? That's why He gave you vision and beautiful sunrises. That's why He gave you feelings and the wonderful warmth of an embrace. That's pleasurable. That's why He gave you ears and the ability to hear marvelous music. That's why He gave you taste buds. He didn't have to give us taste buds, but God designed us for pleasure. And so you can just imagine that heaven is going to be better because the pleasure limits are going to be lifted and there's going to be enormous amounts of joy and pleasure way past what we know now with no unrighteousness. Phenomenal life. Wow. Just past imagining. Just wonderful stuff. You know, sometimes children have my kids ask me, you know, our pet died. You know, is this dog going to be in heaven? Oh, Daddy, tell me the dog's going to be in heaven. You know what I decided? I decided they don't need a theologian to tell them probably not. They need somebody who considers their feelings to say, you know what? If God wants this dog in heaven, you're going to see him again. And you know what? I've come to the conclusion that even no one's going to be disappointed by anything I promise him about heaven. So it's okay to err on the side of making your kids happy, because if they're not there, it won't matter, and if they are, it'll be wonderful, and we don't know for sure, and so why they're already hurt and crying, they're not going to be disappointed by anything we tell them about heaven. You're not going to be disappointed by anything you've ever heard, because it's going to be best. Better than you can imagine. All right, let's read on a little bit farther, because I also took measurements on a map, and I want you to see A picture of this, no, not this one, back to the other one. Here we go. So here's the holy city coming down onto the earth. And you might be thinking, wow, that's too big. That's just too big. The proportion isn't right. But take a look at the map where I printed this out and measured it and drew the 1380 mile square. That is how big the New Jerusalem is. I mean, you're going to a city like that that's this big. Phenomenal. Phenomenal. Wow. See that dot in front of the capital J for Jordan? That's where Jerusalem is. That's where Jerusalem is now. And it's not anywhere near as big as that dot. But the New Jerusalem is going to be enormous and as high as it is wide and long. And you know what? If you ever saw an enormous structure, if you're like me, I'm going, wow, what are they doing the inside? How are they using that space? And if you go back to that cube that's 1,400 miles high, wow, and how much is that? You know, I looked at, Linda helped me look on a map yesterday afternoon. How far is it from here to Dallas? 1,360 miles. So if Los Angeles is just inside the city limits on this side of New Jerusalem, and Dallas is just inside the city limits on the other side of the New Jerusalem, and Seattle and Vancouver, British Columbia are just inside the city limits on that and the northeast west corner, and Winnipeg, Alberta is just inside the upper right-hand corner, the whole western United States is the size of New Jerusalem. Go over to Dallas, draw a line straight up, and all the way over to the Pacific Ocean, that's how big the New Jerusalem is going to be. Wow. I'm impressed. Are you impressed? Wow. So you see, the man we're marrying, bride, has really got it together. And he's got a place for you. Woo! Does he ever? All right. Now, how are we doing on time here? Oh, not too bad. All right. I'm having too much fun. Ministry strategy basis. Now, this is an interesting thing because you don't hear about Jesus much as the bridegroom. But if you look carefully, you're going to find that John the Baptist designed his ministry around the bridegroom analogy. Look at John 3, verses 29 and 30. And this is a phenomenal thing because this is what John had to say after he lost his ministry. What? Yeah, John, thousands of people went out to see John. Let's see John 3. Can you put it up there, please? 29 to 30. Thousands of people went out to see John the Baptist and were baptized in the River Jordan. But after a while, he started telling them that Jesus is the one. Go follow Jesus. And guess what? They did. And so the Pharisees came and said, ha, 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 John the Baptist, you lost your crowd. What do you have to say about that? And John said, he who has the bride is the bridegroom. It's okay. That's the way it's supposed to be. But the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him speaking of himself rejoices because of the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, my joy is fulfilled. Wow. What an amazing spirit and attitude. Shortly after that, he was arrested and beheaded. But his ministry went downhill, and he was happy about it. Collapsed for lack of a following, but he was happy because he knew. Because, see, that was what his ministry was. His ministry was to point the bride to the bridegroom. And so when he saw the bride following the bridegroom, he was done. He had done what he was called to do, and he knew it. The apostles, Jesus told them in Matthew 9:15, because the same Pharisees that were stirring up trouble with John the Baptist tried to stir it up with Jesus' followers, and they came and said, how come your teacher doesn't teach you to fast like John the Baptist did and like we do? And Jesus said, how can the guests of the bridegroom mourn while he is with them? The time will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them, then they will fast. So Jesus told them that he was going to be taken away and that they would mourn. Now we're going to get back to this in a couple of minutes because this is really important. What does mourning mean here? It means grief over the absence of the one you love. Grief over the absence of the one you love. And this is something the church needs to have so that we will fast and so that we will prepare ourselves for him. Paul, in 2 Corinthians 11, showed that his ministry also was based on this whole idea of the bride and the groom. Where is it? 2 Corinthians, 11, 2 and 3. Can we have that up, please? I am jealous for you, he wrote to the Corinthian believers. With a godly jealousy, I promised you to one husband. Who's that? Jesus, to Christ, so that I might present you as a pure virgin to him. But I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds may somehow be led away from your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. So Paul had the picture of gaining a bride, getting her engaged to her fiancé, and purely following and preparing herself for him as the basis of his ministry. And of course, you're familiar with Ephesians 5, where it talks about, that it's always used for teaching on marriages, about Jesus laying down his life for the church and the husbands to do the same. Now, I want to ask you a question. So we see this bridegroom is so phenomenal, so attractive, so enormously worthy of our attention and loyalty. So why hasn't he come back to get us? Well, then I guess it's time to look at the real text for my message tonight, which is Revelation 19:7. And I apologize, I didn't even include it in my directions to the one who's putting this up. But in Revelation, the projector, but Revelation 19:7, let us rejoice and be glad and give God glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. His bride has made herself ready. Now, I've studied eschatology. I wish I had a lot more answers. I've got more questions than I have answers, honestly. And I really appreciate the teaching team of this church that takes a position of humility. We'd like to tell you exactly how it's going to be so we can look like we know what we're talking about. But we do know what the Bible says, but it doesn't say as much as we wish it did. So what about the rapture? Do we believe in the rapture? Of course we believe in the rapture, even though it isn't mentioned anywhere in the book of the Revelation. Now, we feel more confident in what we teach when we say we have the word of two or three witnesses, everything's established. But we also know that the Bible is the inspired word of God. It's plenary inspiration, which means it only has to say it once for us to believe it. And so when Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians about the rapture, that's all it takes. We believe it. But we don't know when it's going to happen. We don't know. You know, it could happen tonight, and then in 7 years, that'll be the end of the tribulation, and we'll see Revelation 19:6, Jesus coming on the white horse to end stuff. Or maybe it could happen in the middle of a 7-year tribulation period, and then the saints will go through part of it, but not have to go through the rest, and then 3.5 years after that, so that it'd be in the middle, 3.5 years after the beginning of the great tribulation, a 7-year tribulation, then that's when we would be raptured out, and then we would come back with Jesus 3.5 years later, Revelation 19. Or it may be like I think, but I hope I'm wrong, but that we have to go through most of the tribulation period and we'll get pulled out maybe a couple of weeks or a month before we come back. In other words, after all of that terrible stuff has happened, and there's amazing pages in here in the book of the Revelation that shows saints, believers, during the tribulation period, almost up to the very end. And then Jesus coming back, taking us just before the final outpouring of God's wrath, and just enough time to have the the Bema judgment that Pastor Luke preached about, the judgment seat of Christ, and then come back on the horses to see the end as our King leads it and makes it happen. So we just don't know. We know it's going to happen, but we don't know when. All right? So, but why hasn't he come back yet? Or it may be that this tribulation started with Jesus' resurrection and what the trouble the apostles went through that we read in the book of Acts, and it's just the same stuff happening over and over and over. You'd have a hard time convincing the underground church in China in 1980 that they weren't in tribulation. Or the church in North Korea today. And, you know, we really appreciate our pastors here. I love the Rockland, and I've been coming here for almost 20 years. But you know what? You may not know that your pastors really are laying down their lives for you. It may not look like it because they're having so much fun. But we have learned to have a great time doing what God's put in our hands, and because we love you and we love to see other people and we love to see them saved and we love to see them growing up in Christ, but these people are laying down their lives for the church. And it may become more obvious in 2 or 3 more years if the tribulation gets worse fast. And it very well could, because it's been getting worse fairly quickly at an increasing rate. And you may see your pastors physically martyred. And you may be with them and martyred with them, some or many of you, when it happens. We don't know what's going on. We don't know what all's going to happen. But I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to help you get ready. Because I think the reason that the church, that Jesus hasn't come yet, is because his bride isn't ready. You know, everything else has happened, except there are a few little spots where there are a few people who haven't heard the gospel yet. And that can be wrapped up very quickly, especially if we get some angelic help. And God can do that if and when he wants to, because he's done it before. But what if Jesus is looking at his church and seeing a drama queen 15-year-old? I'm a high school chemistry teacher. I know what I'm talking about. And my son-in-law is sitting here in the front seat. He also teaches math at Eisenhower High School. I teach chemistry at Rialto High School. And he's come up with a term when some girls start acting up in his class. He says, save the drama for your mama. But so much of the church is like that. Selfish, focused on us, thinking the whole world ought to be about me and getting what I want. And if I'm not getting what I want, then I'm not going to do anything for anybody else. You know? And if Jesus is looking at that, I'm thinking Jesus is saying, nah, a few more years. Not coming back for that. How about a little more maturity? Yeah? How about a little more growing up? How about a little more caring about my kingdom that she's going to help rule? How is she going to learn to make decisions to sit on the throne with me if she doesn't grow up where she is? So, that's why my text is Revelation 19:7, the wedding of the Lamb has come because the bride has made herself ready. So let's take a look at what we need to do to make ourselves ready. I think that we need to intentionally develop. I could make a much longer list, but I just want to share 4 of them with you in about the next 8 or 10 minutes. The first one is a deep longing. We need to intentionally develop a deep longing for our bridegroom. In John 13, we see an interesting thing. Jesus was about to teach one of the most important messages of his life. Verse 34, a new command I give to you in chapter 13, love one another. But before that, he said, my children, verse 33, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I said to the Jews, where I'm going, you cannot come, so now I say it to you. And then he goes on to teach this very, very important thing, a new command I give to you that you love one another. As I have loved you, that's how you need to love one another. By this all men will know that you're my disciples if you love one another. And what does Peter say in verse 30, in the next verse, 36? Peter said, Lord, where are you going? Huh? Peter, didn't you hear what I just told you? Nope. What do you mean you're going away? You see, the rest of it went right over his head because he was so upset that Jesus was leaving and that he couldn't go with him. And that's where he protested and said, oh, I'll follow you anywhere. And Jesus said, oh, yeah, you're going to deny me. Oh, no, I won't. Oh, no, I won't. Oh, no, I won't. But I think that Jesus was more happy with Peter being upset about his leaving than unhappy that Peter missed the next point, because he told him again in the next chapter. But are you upset that Jesus isn't closer to you than he is? And should you be? Hebrews 9, 28. Hebrews 9, 28. Christ offered himself once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly await for him, he will appear a second time apart from sin for salvation. Who is Jesus coming back for? Those who eagerly wait for him. Are you waiting for Jesus? Let's look at 2 Timothy 4:8. We have another. Finally, there is laid up for me. This is 2 Timothy. This is Paul just before he was taken out and killed for the gospel, in prison, knowing he wasn't going to get out. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord righteous judge will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Do you love his appearing? Are you longing for Jesus to come? Do you want him to come? You know, if we love, then we're going to feel some emotions about it. We can do the loving things. Love requires self-control. But at some point, there needs to be a longing for the one we love. And Jesus, I think, is looking for that. He's looking now. He sees us. He sees how distracted we are. He sees how busy we are. He sees how full our schedules are. And he's wondering, I think, when are we going to give him some time? And why am I telling you this? Here you are. You came to worship tonight. Hallelujah. Praise God. And where's the other 15,000 members? But this isn't just about the Rock. Most churches, there are very few churches that have anybody in them on Sunday nights. But developing a deep longing so that we're going to declare that we want him to come and say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Maranatha, would you say it? Maranatha, once more. Maranatha, Lord, come. A second thing we need to intentionally develop is expressive engagement. Now, when we are engaging with somebody, you know, this is an interesting thing. As a school teacher, I watch the kids. And there's a girl that's sitting there in that chair, and she's kind of listless and kind of bored and not paying very well attention and slouched and, you know, not a bad attitude, just no positive stuff going on there. And then a boy comes walking through the door, and she sits up, and her eyes start sparkling, and she's attentive, and what's going on? She's engaging, she's hoping to engage with this guy that she respects and admires, yeah? And similar, the guys do a similar thing. So what's going on? There's an engaging thing that we want in relationship. And it's, in marriage, it's even more important than, shall I say it, sex. We want to know that the person who loves us is paying attention to us. that sees as valuable, that cares about what we're feeling, that wants to come up with a joke once in a while to make us laugh, that wants to invite us out, says, why don't we go out here for dinner? That would be fun. Or let's plan a vacation and do thus and such. Or how could we spend this extra $100 this month in a way that we can both enjoy it? There's something about listening to the news so that you can tell something worthwhile when you get home, if you're driving home and your wife's at home. There's something about the way we can play with one another. Push a little, shove a little, hug a little. Yeah, because that's engaging, and that's how we can worship. Now, Pastor Jim did a great job on worship this morning. Worship is sacrifice. It really is. But there are different kinds of worship, and part of worship is the kind that we do so well as a corporate body here, when with the band and the choir, we're singing together. I mean, we felt heaven this evening in our worship, didn't we? Wasn't that wonderful? But you know what? You can feel that at home, too. You can engage with God. You can spend time with Jesus. You can have him come. You know, and as much as I love to come and worship in the congregation, and I love it, the times that God has visited me, six or seven times, most powerfully, have not been in a worship service setting. It was when God overpowered me. I mean, God showed up and wow! And I'm not talking just about when I was born again or when I was baptized in the Spirit. I'm talking about times when I was at a crossroads in my life and God showed up. Or when I was doing something that I thought was good and right and God said, no, wow. And it took me 2 hours after he said that to start arguing with him about it, as good as I am at arguing, because I couldn't deny that it was God. And it took a couple of hours for me to get out from under that. We don't have free will when God really shows himself maximum, because, man, that's overpowering. And I wish I had time to sing a little song for you that the Holy Spirit helped me write to Jesus one day when I was lying on the carpet in my home, just worshiping Jesus. But some of you are songwriters, and some of you, the psalmist said, sing a new song to the Lord, a new song. Well, maybe some of you can at least praise the Lord in tongues for a little while and make an appointment with him to give some expressive worship, engage with God in your personal time. Another thing that God's looking for is mature obedience. Mature obedience. John 14, verse 21, says an amazing thing. Whosoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. So the evidence of love is obedience, right? And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and will manifest myself to him. If you haven't experienced the presence of God powerfully in the last year or two, then you need to spend some time, take this verse to God in prayer, and say, God, you said that you would do this, and I want you to. Because I have found out that God's waiting for us to ask him before he does things. And so if you learn to ask him, here he wants to show himself to you. But if you obey with expectation and say, God, I'm trying to do what you want. I'm following you. Will you come manifest yourself to me? He may not do it that moment, but if you give him some time on a regular basis, and I'm talking about one-on-one, and I'm talking about complete attention, because you can't have God visit you the way you want him to while you're driving a car. It'll be dangerous for everybody on the highway, including you, because God really does come and manifest himself powerfully to those who seek him and tell him so and ask him to do it, because he promised he would. Now, I don't know how he'll show himself to you, but I believe he will, because he said he would, and I don't think he loves you more than he loves me, and he's shown himself to me in some powerful ways. And one final way that we can intentionally develop to make ourselves ready is authoritative prayer. You know, God, there are a number of things And I just can mention this one instead of going to depth on it. Ezekiel 22, 30 and 31. God wanted to do something, but he couldn't and didn't. Why not? Because he didn't find an intercessor asking for it. Yesterday we had a prayer vigil for the nations. There were about 30 people participated. And I want you to know that the Holy Spirit showed up in little college room, Bible College Room 101. And there are going to be some things different this week in the earth because we took the throne and exercised our authority as a body of Christ. And a lot of people don't know that. So maybe you ought to get a book on prayer. Or sign up for the Bible College. Or come to the world prayer meetings or the pre-service prayer meetings over there. See, there's a door over there against that wall that says New Believers Room. You walk through there a half hour before any service on Sunday or Saturday, and there'll be people in there, and you can pray with them and learn to pray as a body with practice, not just teaching. All right? So anyway, but God won't do anything. He's given the church the keys to the kingdom, and he won't do what he's waiting for us to do, which is another reason to understand that Jesus hasn't come yet because the church isn't ready. Now, I need to ask some of you, are you even engaged to be married to Jesus? Because you don't get to the wedding feast in heaven because you came to church and have been good. You see, Linda didn't marry me until she said yes when I asked her if she would. And if there wasn't a time when you, sir, when you, ma'am, recognized that Jesus was inviting you to give your life to him, then you're not part of the bride. You can't be married until you accept the engagement from the fiancé. And tonight, Jesus is inviting you to marry him. Or maybe you said yes some years ago, but you've been cheating on him since then and dating other guys and spending your time in other places. And you need to, and the astounding mercy of Jesus, God, is that he still wants you anyway. And so he's saying, come. Come, and I will give you life. Come. Say yes. Let me put the ring on your finger and start living as if you're my fiancé. You can't get that by being good. You can't get that by doing works. You can't get that by being born in the right family or at the right time in the right place on earth. That takes a conscious realization of the implication of marrying the King of the universe and saying, yes, I'll be yours and nobody else's like I'm yours. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you're here right now giving that invitation. And there are people about to say, yes, I will. If that's you and you need to give your life to the Lord Jesus for the first time or again after a time not being completely faithful to him, I want you to raise your hand on the count of three. Yep. Eyes open, heads up. We're not ashamed if we're going to accept and become fiancé of Jesus, the bridegroom. On the count of three. One, two, three. Raise your hand if you want to say yes to Jesus tonight. I see that hand. There's one. All right. I see that hand. Thank you. There's two. There's three. There's four. Five, six, seven. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. You're faithful to what you said you would do. All right? Then, a good intention is not sufficient. And the way I'm going to ask you to say yes to Jesus is to stand up in a minute when the rest of the church stands up and walk forward and stand here at the foot of these steps to demonstrate that, yes, you mean it and you want to Jesus to be your, you want to be part of the bride of Christ, and you're ready to give your life to Jesus. Would everyone stand up, please? And those who raised your hands, and if you didn't raise your hand, but you should come anyway, come. Jesus is inviting you. Jesus is waiting. The King of the universe has invited you to sit with him in his throne. But first you have to say yes to the engagement question. Come on, don't be ashamed. Don't be reluctant. This is something to jump for. Hallelujah. Can you turn around and face this way, please? Yeah, face this way. Thank you. Praise God. Hallelujah. You're still coming. Thank you, Jesus. You know, Jesus has been looking forward to this a long time. He's been wanting you, and now you're saying yes. Wow. And we have here Pastor Joel. He's right there, yeah, waved at you. He's going to take you into another room. Nothing weird or strange is going to go on. He's going to lead in you in a prayer to give yourself, to give your heart, to give your life to Jesus, and going to tell you about, going to give you some free literature and tell you about a program we have to help you have a friend that will help you become ready to be the bride of Christ. All right, thank you. Follow Pastor Joel. Go this direction. Thank you. Now, I want the rest of you to sit down for a minute because I've saved the best for the last. Jesus rose from the dead, stayed 40 days on earth, ascended to heaven, and about 60 years later came back to visit, John, the Apostle John on the island of Patmos. And he said, write these letters down, tell my church something. And what do you think Jesus wanted to say to his church? Here we have the King of the universe. He has been back in that city, back in the throne room of God, back in heaven where he's worshiped and adored and where everything is right and just and beautiful. And he's been drinking in amazing, amazing worship. He's been seeing what God likes to do because he is God, back as God on the throne. And so what could he have said to John? There are so many things he could have said. But look at Revelation 2, verse 4. Jesus came back and he dictated 7 letters. He had 7 short messages to his church. And the first one was, why don't you love me like you used to? What? What? This is your great king who came on that horse? This is the one that ended all evil? This is the one who's sitting in the throne room of heaven and he's whining like a baby? No! He's expressing his disappointment that his church doesn't love him. And then there's letters 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and letter 7. And letter 7, chapter 3, verse 20. He says, he ends this little message. After 60 years in heaven, after 30 years on earth, behold, I stand at the door and knock. This is the door of his church. This isn't the door of some sinner. This is the door of his church. I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and dine with you. I'm looking forward to the wedding feast. But you must come, because this is where the verse is about spitting us out of his mouth if we're not hot. He wants a hot bride. He wants a woman who's hungry for him. He wants a bride that's eager and longing for him. And so I not only gave an invitation to those that needed to become engaged to him, I'm giving you an invitation tonight. In a minute, I'm going to ask you to stand up if you're willing to identify yourself on a particular issue. And that is, what will you do? Do you know of something that you will do this week between now and next weekend in which you're going to help make yourself a ready bride for Christ. Now, let me be more specific. A deep longing, one of the ways you can develop a deep longing is to make a date with your fiancé to read his words in one of the Gospels. Are you with me? Another way that you can help make yourself ready this week is by expressively engaging in worship. Sing a new song to Jesus. Make an appointment with Jesus, your fiancé. And if you're not good at music, you know what? He doesn't care. He just wants to feel the love. And you can pray in tongues. Some of you have been baptized in the Spirit, but you haven't used your tongue language hardly ever. When you run, I think one of the best ways to use tongues is when I'm worshiping the Lord, worshiping my Jesus, and I run out of words to say, I can just babble like a baby and let it keep going. And that's worship that I feel powerfully about and Jesus loves. So make an appointment, maybe, would you, to spend some time singing or expressing your love for God. Another thing you could do in terms of becoming mature is deciding to monitor your emotional life and see how much of the many of your hours you're expressing the fruit of the Spirit instead of the anger and frustration and uptightness of the stress and pressure around you. So you can decide right now, this week, I'm going to see if I can go a whole day and have the fruit of the Spirit every hour of that day. What a challenge, huh? One more. You might commit, if you want to develop authoritative prayer life, you might commit yourself to find a book on prayer so that you can develop your prayer life, or you might decide that it's time to talk to your husband or wife or other people in your family about making arrangements so that you can come to the Bible college. I'm not saying everybody needs to come to the Bible college, but it's a great way to learn more about prayer and ministry and how to serve the Lord. Or you might do this. You might want to do some of these works that Pastor Jim is talking about this morning. You could volunteer for a ministry. Maybe you've been riding long enough and it's time to help lift, carry the load. Yeah? All right. Are you thinking about anything? Is anyone? I'm going to ask you in about 60 seconds to stand to commit yourself or to identify yourself if you've thought of a specific commitment. Now, this isn't between you and me. This isn't between you and our pastors. This is between you and Jesus. But if you're ready to say, okay, this is what I'm going to do, you're not telling anybody except Jesus, then would you please stand now to identify yourself as someone who is going on record as you know what, something that you're going to do specific this week to help make yourself a ready bride for Christ. All right? You see them, Lord, and you know what's on their hearts and what's in them. So we thank you and praise you. Everyone else stand up, please. Let's all stand. Almighty God, we thank you and praise you that we are your bride and that you are doing your work in us. We thank you, Jesus, that you've given us authority to do what you want done on earth in our spheres of influence. And we thank you and praise you that we're going to become the ready bride by your grace and the power of your Spirit. In Jesus' name. Did you hear from the Lord tonight? Hallelujah. Amen.
What a great challenge to be the bride that Jesus is waiting for to return. I tell you what, I was challenged today to be a hot bride for Jesus Christ. This church, when it was first founded, it was the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. On the billboard, it used to say, a church aflame. Because this is a church that has always been committed to being on fire for Jesus. To doing everything we can to be ready for our bridegroom's return. So I want to challenge you. You made that commitment. Go out there and do what you need to do to date your fiancé, Jesus Christ. Because he's coming for you. And you got to look enticing to him. So
With that, we want to dismiss you in just a moment. I just want to remind you, this is during the end time series, we have been doing something in the church. We have been receiving a special offering over and above tithes and offerings for the church in the Messianic church in Israel. Now, Israel is primarily Jewish. As a matter of fact, there's only a few thousand people in Israel that are belonging to the Messianic church. And we have been fundraising. We've been gathering an offering over the series, the end time series, to send out and to support directly the Messianic church, your Jewish Christian brothers and sisters in Israel specifically. And the church has already raised well over $8,000. And this is the last time that we're going to receive.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.